Hi, one of the major institutions, in fact, one of the basic five institutions, is the family. And I'd like to talk about massive changes in the family over time. You all know, of course, that the divorce rate has risen dramatically, but you might be surprised to find out while we have a 50% divorce rate in advanced industrial society like the United States, that 150 years ago, 50% of the marriages were also broken, but they were broken by death. So there have been dramatic problems no matter what era we deal with. The family, of course, still serves to be a basic functional unit of society, and when it has problems, it really relates to the rest of society. I want to talk about a guy named William F. Ogburn from the University of Chicago, just up the road here. William F. Ogburn, one of the major sociologists of the early mid-1900s. And Ogburn looked at the family, and he was trying to explain why, as we industrialized, that the divorce rate had risen so radically, why it was so hard to keep families together, why it seemed to be more pressure. And he kind of got to looking at it and thought, well, maybe we're expecting different things. And the divorce rate might really be reflective of just changing nature of expectations. When he looked at the divorce rate, I think one way to look at marriage, is like if we had a basketball hanging in the middle of this room, and that basketball was hanging by one cord. You know, I could hit it and it just flops all over the place. It's very unstable. But then I tie six additional cords to various parts of the room to hold that basketball stable. And every time that I add another cord, that basketball just gets harder and harder to move. I hit it and it just shakes a little bit but comes back to its place. It's pulled taut by all these different pressures. So let's think of that basketball as the family and talk about seven different ropes that have traditionally held the basketball in place, held the family in place, and see how those have weakened or strengthened or changed over time. The first one of those functions that has changed is the economic function. The economic function, and for those of you who grew up on a farm and were serious farmers, you know that the kids weren't just kind of an add-on, the kids were part of the work. Or if you grew up in a business, like my parents owned a restaurant, the kids were an essential part of making that business go or not go. And of course, for most of human existence, kids had very specific things to do. We've gone from the family being a productive unit, in other words, working together to achieve the survival of the family, to being a consumptive unit. In other words, we consume together. When I ask my classes, it's not unusual for lots of families not to have eaten together all that week, not to even sit down at a meal and have a discussion and all been in one place at one time at the same time. It seems to be very common that we're consuming, we're running different directions, we're doing different jobs, we're very busy, we're very active, and yet as a family unit, lots of times we're not spending a lot of time together as a group as in the past. We used to be productive producers and then we moved to being more consumers. Think of that as one of these ties that held this basketball in place that we've just weakened. We've made it less strong. Maybe not cut it, but made it less strong. Number two, he argued that we went in terms of a protective unit. That this went from the family and tribe to more impersonal things such as insurance, police, all very good organizations, but what you see is that here's a unit that's holding the family together. The family is taking blood revenge if somebody hurts a family member, and now we're relying upon the police. Or if our house burnt down, the family and village got together and we rebuilt each other's homes, which created what? Social cohesion, tightness. Now we rely upon an impersonal insurance company. So one more rope's been weakened, according to William F. Ogburn. The third one that he talks about is religious instruction. Now, of course, there's a resurgence. Many families are trying to teach religion, religious values, and doing homeschooling, all kinds of things of that nature to deal with modern issues. But that's still a tiny part of the population. The religious instruction, by and large, according to Ogburn, has gone from a daily family matter in many homes to Sunday school, to churches, to preachers, to somebody else teaching our kids, and then we're kind of, you know, like Archie Bunker on All in the Family, leaving it up to Edith to do the religious instruction. We're leaving it up to the preacher to do the religious instruction. One more tie that's holding the family together, according to Ogburn, that's been weakened here. The fourth one is the education socializing function. And of course, our families still do that. We go on trips together, we go camping, we spend time together. But I heard a guy just the other day saying, you know, he felt so bad when he thought about raising his kid that every night he was so busy thinking about all he had to do in his work that he'd try to rush the kid through the book. He'd try to get the kid to pick a shorter book. He'd try to skip sentences and hope the kid wouldn't notice so he could get the kid to sleep and he could get back to his paperwork. Well, sometimes that's necessary, but Ogburn says that's become all too frequent and that's weakened the ties that bind. In the past, the family has been the primary group that socialized, taught us on-the-job training what we need to know to survive, to make a living, to be a productive member of a tribe or society. And he says that's gone from the family to impersonal groups like schools. And of course, our society is so complex that indeed the schools serve a very good function, but at the same time, they're weakening the power of the family. In fact, people like me or people like other teachers may disagree with your values or may disagree with some of your ideas, and that may weaken the tradition of the family. Of course, that has the good function of broadening one's perspective as well. So now we've got four of these ropes. What's happening to this basketball? What's happening to this family? Well, when we hit it, it's getting a little shakier. It's a lot easier to move around. All right, let me erase these and go to the fifth one. The fifth major function that he says has changed is the status-conferring function. Status is our place in life. And this is both good and bad. It's functional and dysfunctional, this change. It used to be that family name meant everything. You were born into an ascribed status. And it has gone from ascribed, in other words, you're born into a fancy family or you're born into an average family and that's the status of that you're going to have, to an achieved status based upon what you and I do, based on education, based upon inventions, based upon good investments in the stock market or bad investments or whatever. So that the status conferring function that used to be one of those ropes that held the family together has weakened again. So now we've got this ball out here. We've got five floppy ropes not holding it in place very well. So when something comes up like a disaster or a problem and the ball gets hit, the family moves, shakes it all up, makes it harder to stay together, makes it easier to make a decision, say, I'm going to break things here. Number six is the recreational function. I've heard lots of statements about the family that plays together, stays together, and there's a lot of truth there. Obviously, families still do lots of those kinds of things, but if you connect it to the amount that was done in the past where people would spend time together doing recreation just in corner lots, playing baseball, football, not organized by the YMCA or the Boy Scouts or anything of that nature, but just neighborhood stuff, that's declined dramatically. And he says that's gone from the family to formal groups, which are both good and bad, like Boy Scouts. And if the father or the mother is involved in the Boy Scouts or the Girl Scouts, it can be extremely good because it's both family and widening the family circle. But lots of times, of course, it's perfect strangers, people we don't know. And that's one more thing that's kind of decreasing the power of the family. The final one, notice we have six that have weakened, six strands that have weakened that have been holding the family in place fairly tightly. Because every family reaches challenges, everybody has problems, all families need to come to solutions. But why has the divorce rate increased so much? He says the last one, the affection function, or love, romance, has been pushed so hard by our society that it actually has strengthened. Unlike all the rest of these that have weakened, we base our decisions upon who to marry, not who might make the best mate, but more upon do we feel like we've fallen in love with them? Do we still feel like we're in love with them? Of course, that's a fickle feeling. Research has shown that romantic, powerful love lasts anywhere from 6 months to, you know, 2 or 3 years tops, if you look up Helen Fisher's work, a fascinating anthropologist, and that a deeper type of connection has to develop for that family to fit together and to stay together. But if affection's what we're determining as the most powerful rope that's holding our basketball or our family in place, And affection's such a fickle thing. What happens when a good-looking younger guy comes by, or a good-looking younger gal comes by, and the wife or the husband decides, they don't look so bad. Fall in love, you get that rush, that adrenaline feeling, and you're comparing an old love to a brand new fresh love. And many times we break marriages up based upon that, because according to Ogburn, sociologically, the other six factors that used to hold the family together are no longer holding the family together very strongly. Now, this is fascinating because he didn't make this prediction or this analysis in retrospect in 2005 or 10 or 2004. He made this prediction as a result of a blue ribbon panel to the President of the United States, President Herbert Hoover, in 1934. This is when he made his recommendation. He said the American family's divorce rate is going to climb drastically. He was incredibly on target. He was right. Here are the reasons it's going to climb drastically, and here's what we need to do to try to stop it. Okay, one little final comment on the family. I'd like to show you five different countries here. If you look at the United States in surveys, Americans say that they rank love first as the most important thing in choosing and keeping a spouse. You look at a country that is more or less in the third world, a very controversial country, Iran. They ranked love, romance, affection as the third most important thing in marriage, not number one. They ranked education, ambition, and chastity of the partner as higher on the list. Third one, Nigeria in Africa. They ranked love and romance and excitement as the fourth most important reason to get married and stay married. They ranked higher than that good health of your spouse, refinement, neatness, desire for home and children as more important than this heart-pounding, my God, I can't live without him or her love. China, one of the still the largest country in the world. India's about ready to catch up with it, but they ranked love sixth in the reason to choose a mate. Higher than that, they rank things such as health, chastity of the mate again, and homemaker. And then finally, South Africa, the Zulu tribal group of South Africa, they ranked romance and love seventh. Not first, second, but seventh. And they ranked higher than that emotional stability of the partner, the maturity of the partner, and whether the partner could be dependable or not. Income, keeping a good house, etc., things of that nature. Thanks.